Welcome to my talk about temporal prediction and evaluation of brassica growth in the field using conditional generative adversarial networks. I'm Lukas Drees, PhD student of Finorob, and I'm working on this topic with my colleague Jana Kirdorf and my supervisor Ribana Roscher. Please imagine you are a farmer cultivating this field and would like to know what it will look like in 3 weeks, or what about 1 month before the planned harvest. Why would such information be valuable to you? For example, to be able to estimate how much fertilizer you need to apply to the field so that the plants develop in the same way as last year. It would also be practical to know when the field is ready for harvesting. And when I think about breeding, such models could be a benefit there as well. But the question is, how do you come to this knowledge? One possibility would be to just rely on your long experience as a farmer. Another possibility is to consider external factors like the number of sunshine hours and rain amount. Our idea is to generate the future growth state of each plant in the field based only on images and the use of machine learning. So we take a picture of state A of a plant, put it into a conditional gun and predict the state B of this plant X days in the future. And this for all plants in the field. This results in a few more advantages for the farmer. Let's assume that the field is not completely homogeneous in terms of soil quality and there are regions where the plants grow better than in other regions. To detect these regions and to know as early as possible what influence a bad soil quality has on the growth of the plant would be a real benefit. In addition, the farmer has the possibility to refertilize selectively those plants that are very small in prediction. The same applies to stresses or diseases that are often difficult for humans to recognize in early plant stages but can still be detected by machines. With a temporal prediction of these diseased plants in the future, the disease will become more clearly visible. And again, the farmer has the chance to do something about the negative effects at an early stage, for example through targeted spraying. In summary, the idea is to provide farmers with useful information and thus options for action at a very early stage. The basic requirement for this is the georeference observation of the field at different times with an imaging sensor. While it is very hard to observe exactly the same scene twice in many other applications, for smart agriculture this is not a problem at all. More and more fields are monitored by autonomous machines such as ground robots or drones, which are usually equipped with at least one normal RGB camera. We focus in this work mostly on data from the ground robot Ladybird, which is visible on this image. Among many other sensor data, it has taken high resolution images of cauliflower every week at approximately equal intervals. Here are a few examples from the growing season, which in the case of cauliflower is about 10 weeks. We are now following two goals. First, we want to create realistic looking images, and second, we want the images to be meaningful and thus actually usable. For the first goal, I can already anticipate. Yes, it is possible to create such images that look realistic and could represent real grown phenotypes of the source image. With a 2-week growth model, for example, it is possible to derive from week 2 how it would look like in week 4, from week 4 how it would look in week 6, and so on. Before I present approaches to evaluate the image, I would like to introduce the methodology that we use to create the images. To solve the task of image generation, we use a conditional generative adversarial network. But what actually is a generative adversarial network, in short GAN? Typically, GANs are used to generate images from noise, and they usually consist of two networks working adversarial, the generator and the discriminator. The task of the generator is to generate images that look real, while the task of the discriminator is to distinguish fake images from real images. In our case, we have on the input side not only noise, but an input image of a real plant, which makes the gun a conditional gun. This is crucial because we don't want to generate just any random arbitrary plants, but the shape of the generated plant should depend on what it looked like in the past. In other words, the condition we are inserting is a previous growth stage of the generated plant. While both networks are very poor at the beginning, they will improve step by step through adversarial training with training image pairs. For more details regarding the architecture and the whole training process of a conditional gun, I would really like to answer your questions afterwards. Please also have a look at the PIX2PIX image-to-image translation architecture on which our methodology is based on. Assuming we are now done with the training, we can just look at the images and decide if they are good or bad, but this is very subjective. So we need to think about how to evaluate the fake images objectively. This is where the Fréchet inception distance comes into play. It basically compares the Gaussian distributions of embedded features of the input images. And as you can see in the graphic, the FID score is lower the more similar the image distributions are. The second evaluation method focuses even more on the cauliflower itself. So, since the background is not interesting for us anyway, we estimate the cauliflower instances on both the fake and the test images. The parameters of corresponding instances, like segmentation area, width or height, are hopefully similar and can be compared afterwards. To calculate the instances, we used a masker CNN structure of Detektron 2 and traded with some labeled data. With this evaluation, we want to make sure, as already announced, that the images do not only look realistic, but are also meaningful. In other words, that parameters of reference and reference image and fake images match as closely as possible. Let me summarize the pipeline again. It basically consists of three steps. First, we train a conditional gun, for which we need image pairs of different growth stages. In the next step, we take previously unseen images and predict new fake images. And third, we evaluate the fake images by calculating instance segmentation and the FID score. With this, I would like to present you some experiments and results. Our study site consists of four beds, where two are planted with cauliflower. First of all, we divide our field into a training region and a test region. And it is also important to mention that the parts of the field are put under different conditions in terms of fertilization and irrigation. So I plus F minus, for example, mines good irrigation but no fertilization. Both training and test bed are divided into four equal size areas of these conditions. In this first experiment, our goal is to model a growth of 3 weeks. Therefore, we use all images with an interval of 3 weeks together, which result in 1,200 image pairs per bed. And this is how the result images for the different weeks look like. On the left side is the input at state A, on the right side the actual appearance of the plant at the advanced stage B, and in the middle is the fake prediction. If you didn't know better, you could take the fake pictures for a real plant in most cases, at least in this resolution. Of course, if you look closely at the plant, you will still find some blurrings and some unnaturally shaped leaves, but the first impression is pretty good. If we take these images and apply instance segmentation to them, we can see that cauliflower can be detected with a relatively high degree of certainty on both images. In the following, we would like to focus on comparing the segmentation area, which is the amount of pixel covered by the plant, in order to check if the predicted plants have the right size. When we now scatter all corresponding fake and test areas, we can get an impression of how good our generator is. Some weeks are systematically predicted slightly too large, like week 5 and 8, and others a little too small, like week 7. So the most points are along the gray optimal line with R square value of 0.66, which is not bad. In the following, we look at the distributions of the data for the different conditions. We analyze again the segmentation area and calculate the mean value and the standard deviation over the different weeks. It is directly noticeable that the plants are getting larger with good irrigation, indicated as green and blue lines, and this is also the case in our fake images. If you now go through it week by week, you will notice that the predictions are really good in the beginning and become a little less accurate in late weeks, which can be recognized by the fact that the fake and test parameters do not match well anymore and the standard deviation becomes larger. There are some reasons for this which have to do with typical problems with observations in the field, like camera outages, bad camera calibration, or overlapping plants. In the next step, we have calculated the FAD score for the comparison fake test, fake train, and test train. It turns out that the fake images have higher similarities to the test set than to the train set, which is a very good sign. As an extension of this experiment, we trained the model only on half of the training data set, which is the region of good irrigation. The expectation is that test plants from this region will actually be predicted well, while the test plants from the regions with poor irrigation will become larger than they should. Because with this model we pretend that the plants with poor irrigation grow under good irrigation during the 3 weeks of prediction. In fact, it can now be seen that cauliflowers from the poorly irrigated area usually grow too large, while normally irrigated plants are more in line with actual sizes and in late weeks actually tend to be underestimated. This can also be seen in the higher R squared value 0.82 compared to 0.33. For computing the FAD score, we average I plus and I minus regions, and one can see that on the one hand, I plus is lower and therefore better predicted than I minus, and on the other hand, the poorly irrigated plants moved further away from the FAD scores in experiment 1 on this test site than the well irrigated plants. The bottom line of this experiment is that we can derive valuable information for the farmer from the generated fake images. To ensure that the problems in high growth stages are really due to problems in the field, we conducted a second similar experiment with plants from the laboratory. Here we use a dataset of the plant Arabidopsis thaliana, and the complete observation period is 35 days, and we no longer predict a 3-week growth, but a growth of 17 days. This is possible by a daily observation of the plant, and in total our training set consists of 10,000 image pairs from which we use 3/4 for training and 1/4 for testing. The scatter result clearly shows that the segmentation area of fake and test matches impressively well. So you can see this by the R squared value of 0.95. Although the spread increases in late growth phases, this is due to the fact that the greater the size, the greater the variability in the training data. In the illustration of the daily development of the segmentation area, one sees only a minimal overestimation of the fake image and overall very small differences. Also in advanced growth stages there are no problems because the images were taken in a way that the plant was taken completely and without overlapping. The FAD evaluation is also plausible. The comparison between fake and test ends up roughly in the range of the previous experiments. Fake train is slightly higher and test train is so much lower because we are working on the basis of a laboratory dataset and the training images actually have great similarities to the test set. Let's come to a brief summary. We found that our conditional gun is able to predict not only realistic looking images, but also meaningful fake images of plants, which we evaluated with instant segmentation and FAD score under different field conditions. It should be emphasized that the generation is unsupervised and only require images that show the same scene at different times. Therefore, it would be easy to compute other growth models, for example, a 1 or 2 week growth, or it is no problem to perform the generation the other way around, which could be used to fill, for example, gaps in time series data. When I finally look into the future, we will try to predict growth from multiple previous stages for an even more realistic outcome. Moreover, our work is based on the assumption so far that all external factors are expressed in the shape of the plant. This is not always true. There's a variety of influences such as weather, soil quality, fertilization, seed density, and so on, which directly or indirectly affects the phenotype of the plant. Therefore, it is our goal to add some of these other influencing factors as additional conditions to achieve more reasonable results. It is also planned to generate even more complex fields, such as images with many small instances and fields with mixed cropping. For details on our datasets and methodology, please also have a look at our references. And if you have any questions, please do not hesitate to contact me personally or by mail. That's it. Many thanks for your attention.